Hello, I'm Eve Middleton-Kelly, and I'm the founder and director of the Complexity Research Program at the London School of Economics. You will remember that in week two, we looked at the generic characteristics of complex systems, and we're going to use the understanding from those characteristics to now address the challenge of how do we manage complex systems. Now, if you remember, we finished the earlier video by saying that we cannot manage complex systems in the sense of designing them and predicting and controlling their behavior. So if we cannot manage them in that way, then what do? We need a different way of understanding what, quotes, management means by using our insights from complexity theory. Now, one other thing I would like to say before we start is that although I will be explaining some of the theory has been applied in practice. And I will finish today's video by giving you an example that we are working as part of the World Economic Forum. The World Economic Forum has set up a new global agenda council on complex systems. And for more than a year now, we have been working with the Catastrophic Risks Council to actually look at pandemics. And I will explain this at the end. But what I'm trying to say is that at the highest level, complexity theory is now being acknowledged as being able to make a contribution to very difficult complex problems. So let's have a look at what in fact we can do. What does complexity offer? By understanding the characteristics of complex systems, we can work with them instead of constraining them. Secondly, by seeing complex systems as multidimensional, again, we can address them more effectively. And thirdly, we can approach complex challenges in a more appropriate way. And we will look at all those in turn. First of all, we need to understand what does inadvertently constrain mean? For example, when we want to be innovative, and you remember last time I kept repeating innovation, and we do not facilitate self-organization and exploration of the space of possibilities, then we will not actually achieve our objective. So it is, how do we work with those characteristics to achieve our objectives without inadvertently constraining them? The other thing that complexity thinking helps us to do is to address what we might call apparently intractable problems. These are problems such as organizational transformation, political conflict, believe it or not, major geopolitical issues, climate change, infrastructure systems, energy. These are apparently intractable problems in the sense that they are very difficult, they do not have a single solution or a simple solution, and they're very, very difficult to address. But also to address future challenges. It doesn't have to be in the past only. Now, complex problems often appear intractable because of the way they are addressed. They are not necessarily inherently intractable. They may appear intractable, and let me explain how we often make a mistake. Complex problems or challenges have multiple dimensions. By multiple dimensions, I mean they can be cultural, they're organizational, technical, physical, political, financial, etc. And yet what we often do as humans is choose one of those dimensions and focus on that to the exclusion of all others. For example, we might say, it's only a technical problem, or it's only a financial problem, or it's only a cultural problem. And we actually focus on that dimension and we do not address all the other dimensions. And we cannot actually do that, because the dimensions are interrelated. Remember what I had said in week two. These characteristics, these dimensions are interrelated, interconnected, and they co-evolve. They actually influence and change each other. The other point is we very often focus on a single cause. We say A causes B. So if I were to drop this, it will fall because of gravity. I can explain that as linear causality. Complex problems cannot be explained in that way. They have multiple interacting, co-evolving causalities. So how do we actually go about understanding the multiple dimensions and the multiple causalities? Let me give you an example, because what I have just said is theory. Let's look at practice. At the moment, we are working with a government agency in Indonesia that is responsible for forests. And deforestation is a big challenge for them. Indonesia has the third largest forest in the world, and therefore it is very important to climate change. And the point is, they really want to reduce deforestation, but they have many, many challenges. What we did, we work with that team last March, and we took them through a methodology that is based on the logic of complexity to actually identify the multiple dimensions of the problem space and the multiple interacting causalities. But it is not enough to simply have a list. We do not just want a list of dimensions, a list of issues. What we try to understand is look at the connections between them. And we would choose a richly connected cluster of issues with multiple dimensions. Because the whole point is, how do they influence each other? How do they co-evolve? Because if we don't understand those co-evolutionary dynamics within the multiple dimensions, we cannot address such a very complex problem. And let me just give you three of the issues that we identified. One was corruption, the other was nepotism, and the third were what they call gangs. But what gangs mean is ethnic and religious groupings. Now, these three actually affect the problem of deforestation. So what we try to do in that project is, first of all, identify the multidimensional problem space. Why? Because searching for a single, universally applicable solution simply does not work. What we need are multiple microstrategies, which are part of a coherent overarching framework, which is part of an enabling environment. And this is the second big idea I want to present to you. So the first one is the idea that a complex problem or challenge has multiple dimensions and multiple causalities, and the way to address them is through an enabling environment, not a single solution. But there's something else as well. All the dimensions in that cluster that we have identified need to be addressed at the same time. We cannot say, today we will address culture, tomorrow we will address organizational structure, the day after we will address the financial. No, that cannot happen, because we are again isolating a single dimension, focusing on it, and leaving the others. And by focusing on it, we will always make a difference, but at the cost of everything else. For example, in the UK, our National Health Service keeps suffering all the time from targets being imposed by the government. These targets can always be met, but at a huge cost in other areas. So we need to address, to set up the enabling environment by addressing the key dimensions, not everything, but the clusters we have identified. We need to address them all at the same time and at multiple scales. What I mean by multiple scales? What does an individual need to address them? What does a group need? What does the organization need? In other words, do we need new resources? Do we need different skills? What is it that we need in order to address it? So an enabling environment is something that is evolving and co-evolving with this changing external environment. And it is these conditions that we have to set up to keep on and on addressing our complex problem. So what is an enabling environment? An enabling environment is set up as a co-creation activity. A CEO or a head of an organization cannot say, as of tomorrow, I will set up the enabling environment. What that leader does is actually starts the process, but by himself or herself, they cannot actually create it. This is a co-creation activity. It takes everyone else involved in that social ecosystem to actually co-create the enabling environment. It needs that distributed intelligence to actually do it. Now remember, creating an enabling environment, which is conducive to change, and the emergence of new ways of organizing. We cannot predict, we cannot control what will emerge. We cannot even design it in detail. We can set up the conditions that will facilitate it, that will encourage it, but we cannot control it and predict it. We also need to facilitate self-organization and the exploration of the space of possibilities. Remember all these principles from week two. We are building capacity to continue that process of co-evolution with a changing internal and external environment. This is not a one-off. This is a constant evolving, co-evolving process. So an enabling environment needs clarity of vision. It needs clarity of identity and clarity of direction. But that does not mean control. It also needs the appropriate governance structure. We really do need to rethink what governance means of a complex system. It is not the same as the governance in the traditional way that we've been thinking about it. There also needs to be coherence between the disparate parts of the organization, which is based on good communication and feedback. Again, remember what I said about feedback in week two. And what it requires is distributed leadership. This idea that leadership is not necessarily just the person at the very top. There are leaders within any organization that actually emerge as new demands actually come up. So we need to actually enable, facilitate distributed leadership. I want to finish now with the way I started, because I mentioned the project we're doing as part of the World Economic Forum in terms of pandemics. So we're looking at pandemics. This is an example on your screen of H1N1 in 2009. Now, what we came to understand with the work we've been doing on pandemics, looking at them from a complexity theory perspective, is that we cannot focus on a single dimension. All the work that's been done up till now focuses on healthcare. But if a pandemic strikes, and you can see on your screen how many countries had been affected, and if it's a pandemic that actually affects people from and stops them working, the impact will be on water, on food, on transportation, on communications, on security, etc., etc. It is not a single dimension. We actually need to look at all these different dimensions that are going to be impacted. Also, it is not a matter of just responding when it happens. We need to prepare. We need to understand what happens when the incident actually happens and the speed of the spread. And then we need to understand the impact of that pandemic, and finally recovery. All those four are interconnected. We need to understand the complex problem space in all four stages and how they interact with each other. Because I think it logically you can see that the better the preparation, the less the impact on the other three. So this is part of the work that we're doing with the World Economic Forum. And again, just to remind you that this is taken, this has a practical application and is taken seriously at the highest global level. So some concluding reflections. An organization needs to be seen as a whole, interconnected and interdependent system with multiple dimensions and issues that interact, co-evolve and change each other. Understanding our organizations as complex systems enables us to work with their characteristics and to enable desirable behaviors which we cannot mandate or control. So I think that brings us full circle from our earlier discussion in week two that complex systems cannot be designed, controlled, and their behavior cannot be predicted. And this particular video showed us how we can actually manage complex systems. It's a completely different approach by understanding the problem space and co-creating the enabling environment. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.